For those sort of holding their breath, waiting to see what has come out or will come out of the Manhattan DA's investigation into Trump's finances, there's some developments. And that is that a prosecutor who was working on that case has resigned in protest, in part because he says Trump is guilty as hell and he doesn't know if he will be indicted and the person leading this investigation will indict him. So this is Trump, this is his piece in the New York Times where he writes, Trump is guilty of numerous felonies, a prosecutor who resigned says. This is about his resignation letter. The prosecutor is Mark F. Pomerantz, who submitted his resignation last month after the Manhattan District Attorney Alvin Bragg abruptly stopped pursuing an indictment of Mr. Trump. Mr. Pomerantz's February 23rd letter offers a personal account of his decision to resign and for the first time states explicitly his belief that the office could have convicted the former president. Mr. Bragg's decision was, quote, contrary to public interest, he wrote. He also writes that the team that's been investigating Mr. Trump, of which he was a part, harbors no doubt about whether the committed crimes he did. Remember, the current lead prosecutor is Mr. Bragg, Alvin Bragg, or the district attorney is Alvin Bragg. His predecessor was Cyrus Vance, and who decided in his final days in office to move toward an indictment, leaving Mr. Trump just weeks away from likely criminal charges. But Mr. Bragg's decision seems for now to have removed one of the greatest legal threats Mr. Trump has ever faced. Pomerantz says, look, no case is perfect, but whatever the risks bringing the case may be, I'm convinced the failure to prosecute will pose much greater risks in terms of public confidence in the fair administration of justice. So Bragg's is not moving forward as of yet. There's not been a no, there will not be an indictment, but it doesn't look like he is as close as his predecessor Cyrus Vance was. David, what are your thoughts on this development?
Well, unfortunately, my thoughts are shaped by years and years of covering special counsels and grand juries. And the one thing that has always been drilled into my head by prosecutors, people, Department of Justice, is that when they are investigating somebody who is a public official, a governor, a congressman, a senator, a president, a former president, whatever, that they always feel an extra burden because their career, these prosecutors say, gets ruined if they charge somebody who might be popular in certain quarters politically and they're not able to make a conviction stick. That it's right. Fine when you can indict anybody, but a prosecutor's career gets ruined if they bring a charge against a governor, senator, or former president and they cannot convict. And that's why, unfortunately, because of prosecutors and their own concern about their own reputation, generally have a higher threshold, a higher standard for indicting a public figure than, say, indicting you or I. Now, the thing about Mark Pomerantz, which is so interesting, is that he actually does have experience bringing public corruption cases against public officials. He's put away a lot of mob bosses. If anybody would know the strengths and weaknesses and the chances of getting a conviction against Donald Trump, it would be Mark Pomerantz. But Alvin Bragg comes in January and suddenly thinks, God, do I want my career as Manhattan Attorney General, my lifelong reputation to be determined by, okay, an indictment against Donald Trump, the first indictment of a former sitting president, and then to lose that in court. And for whatever reason, Bragg felt like the evidence was not strong enough. Not that Donald Trump, look, everybody agrees, Donald Trump inflated asset values. There's no disagreement there. But in order to get a conviction, you have to prove intent. You have to show that Donald Trump knew what he was doing and knew that it was against the law. And that's where Bragg and Pomerantz disagreed. They agreed that Donald Trump, the evidence was there, he inflated asset values and he benefited from it. But could they convince a jury that Donald Trump, as slippery as he is, actually knew that what he was doing was illegal? That's where the divide was. And unfortunately, look, you know, different prosecutors, Cyrus Vance clearly, if he had been in office another few months, would have pulled the trigger and said, yeah, indict him, let's see how this plays in court. But Alvin Bragg was scared, and that's too bad.
Yeah, no crap. I mean, like, I you know, you understand this better than I do, but it is just also, it seems difficult to prove given that a lot of white collar crime is difficult to prove, given that it is technically legal and that a lot of other folks do it. I mean, I don't know, is it technically legal, or can you make the argument that other people do it all the time, or I didn't know, or I wasn't, God, I've got so much money and so many assets. How was I supposed to know what was going on in this account over here or that account over there?
And those are all defenses that would have come up in a trial, and prosecutors better have their ducks lined up and be able to show that no, Donald, sure, a lot of people do this, but a lot of people do it and they get caught and there's a paper trail and they break the law. But that is, you know, that is a defense that prosecutors would run into. And usually what happens in these cases is when somebody's putting together an indictment, they write what's called a prosecution memo. And the memo identifies, here's the charges we're thinking of bringing, here's the case law, and here's the strengths and weaknesses of the evidence, and here's some of the arguments we expect the defense to put forward in their strengths and weaknesses. And then everybody in the prosecution office has to debate over this pros memo. They got as far as actually writing the pros memo under Pomerantz, and they circulated the memo to Alvin Bragg and his, you know, new team that came in. But then Bragg shut out Pomerantz and shut out his associate Casey Dunne, and Bragg and his own team had their own discussions. And during those discussions, was it just about the law? Was it just about the evidence? Or did they have the calculation that a lot of prosecutors have about, you know, we're new, we're establishing our careers. If we bring the first case against a former president and we don't get a conviction, we are toast. Was that part of the conversation? I gotta believe it was, and I think they blinked.
That's so depressing. I mean, it kind of reminds me of the Robert Mueller investigation, which essentially it's like literally all of these people fell in relationship doing the bidding of this president, except the president himself cannot be indicted or convicted, or there was no criminal case there. That's BS. You've got Michael Cohen currently serving time carrying out financial crimes on behalf of Donald Trump, but somehow this president is like immune. I mean, when do people take the shot? I understand you don't want to miss, but like, so what? So you miss, and so your prosecutorial days, maybe they're numbered, but you get a podcast, you get a show on Netflix. I don't know.
Like, yeah, it's for the greater good. I mean, justice is served. If somebody's innocent and a jury finds that Donald Trump did not technically break the law, okay, then he's cleared, he's vindicated. But in my view, prosecutors should have more courage than Alvin Bragg had. And unfortunately, what we see time and time again is that, yes, the difference between Michael Cohen and somebody else is Michael Cohen was not a publicly elected official. He was just an ordinary schlub like the rest of us, who if we did what Donald Trump did, we would get indicted. But Donald Trump, because he was a public figure, because he was a former president, he gets a higher standard. It's not fair, but unfortunately, that's how it works.
Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want, with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.